much left. The only clause that still gives the West some power is the non-recognition of China as a market economy, which can be used in anti-dumping investigations. For instance, if the US says China is selling leather at a dumping price, the investigation can use the cost structure not of China, which isn't a market economy, but of Brazil or a country with a comparable economic level. So they can prove dumping, even if there was no actual dumping, so that the US can introduce retaliatory tariffs. But that will expire in 2016, so that after that, China will be given fair treatment. Well, of course, there is dumping in many cases. It's just that it's not always. The huge reserves which China has and can't do anything with, and is trying to invest a little bit of it in the real economy of other countries, but still, it's a lot of money. Like, for instance, China has been one of the most avid buyers of Greek and Portuguese bonds, and it's not because they are such a great deal, it's just that they have to diversify and there isn't anything else big enough on the market. Oh, the third one is an interesting story. It's the Boeing versus Airbus game. When China is friendly with Europe, it buys more Airbus planes. If things go, something goes awry in Europe, it buys more Boeings. And in 2008, China, Nicolas Sarkozy, met with the Dalai Lama of Tibet, who the Chinese government considers is a criminal. So because he wants, well, not full independence, but more autonomy for Tibet. So the Chinese government delegation that year went to several European countries and made huge orders of high-speed trains and equipment, which creates a lot of jobs and revenue for European economies. And it went around France, it visited all countries around France that didn't go to France. So France was left out of the deals that year. And then next year, of course, relations got better because Nicolas Sarkozy realized he has to do business with China. Also, China has been importing, buying a lot of foreign technology. It has been stealing a lot of foreign technology when it can. But it has also been producing its own technology, developing it, so that it can become more independent and at some point even start charging for its technology. Because, for instance, now the DVD technology is owned by two global consortia, which charge, well, it used to be about $10 5 years ago for every DVD produced in the world. Now it's probably much less. But it was basically 15 European, American, and Japanese companies which own the technology and they charge for it. So China is trying to do something like this. Also China, because it doesn't care that much about the ethical debate, it does a lot of research in cloning, in genetically modified crops, in nuclear, which isn't bad. It's just that in the US or in Europe, you know how the debate is influenced by the popular opinion. And the last thing that China has, that the West can use against China, is the weapons embargo introduced in 1989 after the Tiananmen protests, which China has been calling on the West to drop. But the US will never do that, because if there is a conflict over Taiwan, the US has to defend Taiwan and basically it would have to fight against its own weapons. While in Europe, Europe is ambivalent. Germany and France want to sell arms to China, so they want the embargo dropped. But the UK and the Netherlands, which are more better allies of the United States, are still supporting the embargo. So basically, the West is increasingly less influential on China, but that's just the influence has been in the last 150 years. Before that, China was a global player. They didn't meet much with the West, but occasionally they did. In the Indian Ocean, when the Portuguese started entering the Chinese, there was a lot of interaction. And Marco Polo once, supposedly. And the growing role of China is actually both a blessing and a threat for the West, like this symbol. It's all how you make, well, what you make out of it, and where you position yourself, whether you can benefit or lose from China's growing importance. And I have my email here. If you want this presentation, I can send it to you. And if you have any questions, just let me know by email. Thank you. And for now, if you have questions. With China? Let me see. The question is how you can make money dealing with China if you are Bulgarian. That's hard. I mean, I wrote an article about that 4 years ago, but it's not that relevant anymore. I was saying construction companies can go build in China, like they used to do in Russia, the Glass Bulgarstroy story. You can export cosmetics, like the Chinese go crazy for rose oil, because it's a great gift. And when a Chinese tourist or like a dignitary comes to Bulgaria, they buy not only the small rose oil, but the more expensive essence, and they buy like hundreds of them. Just when they go back, they have to give a gift to everyone and to all the family. And you've probably seen Chinese tourists. I remember seeing Chinese tourists in Belgium with loaded with chocolate, like really bags, 3 or 4 bags full of chocolate. And then they think of something, that's what they know Belgium for, and they buy chocolate. If they come to Bulgaria, you can't sell them much, but... Well, wine is increasingly... They have a little bit of wine, and it's very low quality. But, well, they drink, but they add Sprite to it, or Coke, which to them is okay. And it happens with even, like, very expensive French wine. They still mix it with cocktail. So wine could be an option. I think I know someone who is exporting wine in China. Well, tourism is... the Chinese don't go... They like traveling for the experience. Well, they're increasingly going skiing, so that's a possibility.
And they go gambling.
That's a big thing. And it's illegal in China. In Macau, it's legal in Macau, the former Portuguese colony, which was returned to China. So Macau is now the biggest gambling revenue